Welcome to session three of District Dialogues. We'll be talking today to educators, advocates, and policymakers about strategies to increase digital access and make education more equitable. If you're watching live, please type any questions or comments into the chat. I'll be monitoring it so I can respond in real time. We'll also hope that you'll join the conversation online via social media by using the hashtag District Dialogues. If you're watching a replay, please continue to use the hashtag because we really do want this to be the beginning of an ongoing conversation. And be sure to tag us on your social media posts so that we can see them as well. Before we dive into session three, let's take a quick look back at what we heard from educators in sessions one and session two about the challenges and the opportunities of virtual environment. If you haven't had a chance yet to watch sessions one or two, you can see the videos on our webpage or also on our YouTube channel.
There was already a technology gap, and COVID just highlighted it, expanded it, and then blew it up. We're used to having spotty internet. We're used to having spotty cell phone coverage. But with COVID, there was so much more stress on the existing infrastructure that caused problems. It also limited the access, bandwidth, and everything for people even further out and down the line. So if you're, again, living paycheck to paycheck or have limited finances, you're probably using your phone for your internet. It is very difficult to write a paper on a cell phone.
The students didn't have devices that they needed. A lot of them didn't have computers. They didn't have internet.
And then because the K-12 schools were also out, there was initially the, okay, what am I going to do with my kids? And they want to play with my phone. Or, you know, I'm trying to get them someplace where they have Wi-Fi. And then as we went to virtual school, many of the schools worked to provide Wi-Fi at their building or on buses. And so it was, how do I get to a place where my child and I can use the internet? And if you don't have a car, it's a challenge to find someone who's willing to lend you a car to sit in a parking lot for 4 hours so your kid can go to school. That's just not really a realistic ask.
The biggest problem about the virtual learning is that the parents are working and nobody home to supervise these students. And that is a big problem. They'll turn that device on and they may go somewhere else. And a lot of the homes are not situated for that kind of learning because you got the brothers and sisters and they can come by and aggravate them.
There were several programs using CARE funding that allowed us to provide Wi-Fi hotspots, laptop loans, on a limited basis access to computer labs, but it really, that technology gap, access to the appropriate technologies for the needs that now exist, I think was the biggest thing that we've dealt with and are continuing to work on.
You're talking about kids that never even used those Chromebooks before, and so they don't even know how to maneuver around, and the parents are not able to help them.
We can expect them to do a whole, you know, writing on the computer when they don't even know where each letter is.
We heard about kids and families struggling, but we also heard about a lot of bright spots and about the potential for the future.
Technology has allowed us to get the best teachers and innovative coursework to students who normally would not have had access to that.
Once we get through this COVID, that's going to be beneficial from having gone through all this, is that we will have those computers. And so we will have teachers teaching face-to-face, and then they'll be able to use the computers and technology and software programs to supplement their teaching, which should increase the level of learning for every child.
Of course, fulfilling that potential means building out the infrastructure, which can be difficult in many areas of the country. So what will it take to extend digital access to everyone who needs it? That's the subject of our next panel. But before we start that conversation, let's look at the size of the technology gap.
The story of broadband is not as simple as cities having access while rural areas lack connections. When breaking down broadband subscriptions by the size of a city, suburb, or rural town, we see that suburban households have the largest number of broadband subscriptions, followed by cities of all sizes, and lastly, rural areas. When using these same geographic categories to look at states in the 5th Federal Reserve District, we can see how the percent of broadband subscriptions varies by state. In Maryland, for instance, households in rural towns are more likely to be connected than households in cities. The opposite is true in neighboring Virginia. In all 5 states, suburbs have the most households with broadband subscriptions. Turning to home internet access by race and ethnicity, research shows that 4% of Asian children in the U.S. have no internet access at home, or only have internet access through a smartphone. This is also the case for 7% of white non-Hispanic children in the United States. For Hispanic children in the United States, this number sits at 19%. 21% of black children in the United States face these same connectivity issues. Lastly, 30% of American Indian and Alaska Native children in the United States have either no home internet access or only have access via a smartphone. Household income also plays a role in broadband access. 26% of children who fall into the bottom quartile of family incomes have no home internet access or only have access through a smartphone. However, when looking at the top quartile of family incomes, this number drops to just 2%.
Hi, I'm Abigail Crockett from the Richmond Fed's Research Department. I'm excited to be joined today by Oleta Garrett Fitzgerald, Director of the Children's Defense Fund's Southern Regional Office, John Sallet, a Senior Fellow at the Benton Institute for Broadband and Society, and Alex Marré, Regional Economist at the Richmond Fed. We'll be talking about the role of digital infrastructure in education during the COVID-19 pandemic, and how we can ensure students from all backgrounds can benefit from increased digital access. Thank you all for being here. As we sort of unpack what this digital inequity looks like, Oleta, I would like to hear from you about what full digital equity looks like for children in the United States and how we're falling short of this.
What, for me, equity would look like opportunities that got presented back in the 1940s, when the country decided to electrify all of America, that there would be a specific, targeted, financed government effort to incentivize broadband access. I heard somebody say not having internet in 2021 is like not having lights. So, you know, if we don't fix this divide, we are not going to be able to ensure that all children have an equitable access to participate in an economy where they can escape generational poverty and take care of themselves and their families.
Alex, what are the incentives for investing to increase this vision of digital equity?
Typically, we think of investment dollars for economic development either being focused on people or places. So that means that the dollars directly go to people who need it to improve their skills through education, or can go to places to help provide infrastructure, say built infrastructure. Broadband is kind of unique in the sense that you spend money here and it has benefits in both of those areas. So, you know, as we're talking about today, it allows students to be able to access more online content. It enables rural school districts to be able to tap teachers who maybe can't be in a classroom at a certain point in time, but they're somewhere else. Well, now they can teach multiple schools at the same time. So you get that benefit. But there's also this benefit that schools can have in rural communities overall. I did some research looking at the impacts of improving school quality in rural communities across the country. And just looking at one indicator, we found, you know, the higher that you're able to increase test scores, the more people you are able to attract to rural communities. People want to move to places where they know that their kids are going to get a good education. And so I think that's the promise that broadband holds for rural communities.
Jonathan, given this vision of full digital equity and the incentives we have to invest, what solution, specifically thinking about a policy or a program, do you think America should focus on next? And what are the barriers standing in the way?
It's very likely that a lasting impact of the pandemic is to change the nature of broadband use. There's an economist at Stanford that we quote in our October report who has this as a notion. Prior to the pandemic, about 5% of working hours were worked from home. In the spring of 2020, that went to 50%. He estimates that when the pandemic ends, it'll be 20%, down from the peak, but four times higher than it was before the pandemic. And think about the same usage curve bending upward for education, for healthcare, for job training, for social services, for engaging in the community in multiple ways. We have increased demand, and the current definition of broadband that, for example, the Federal Communications uses is just too slow. So one thing that needs to happen, particularly, I think, if government funds are being used, is that we need to spend public money to build future-proof networks. We need to focus on networks that can meet future demands. In the Benton report, we identified four areas of challenge. One, of course, is digital equity. Digital equity meaning that affordable broadband is available to communities of color, to unserved and underserved populations. Secondly, and the rural example illustrates this, but it is also places in urban America, it's true, there just aren't networks. There aren't networks. If you don't have a network, you can't connect. Thirdly, competition. We ought not forget what the lack of competition does. There are places in the country, urban and rural, I think in particular, where there are only one provider, a monopoly provider. And basic economics teaches us that when that happens, prices tend to be higher, quality tends to be lower. And then finally, to come back to education, we need to really empower our community anchor institutions. And by that, I mean schools and libraries and the like. Healthcare facilities, of course. Let me, if I can just take a minute and tell you one story. So around 1995, there were a bunch of us, we were all young, internet wonks, right, policy types. And we had a meeting and we recommended that President Clinton issue a call in a State of the Union address to connect by the year 2000 every classroom and every clinic and every library. Looking back at that a quarter of a decade later, there's an aspect to that that's very dated. We were talking about building. We weren't talking about people. We were talking about a classroom. We weren't talking about a student or a clinic, not about a patient, or a library, not about a reader. What we've learned now, if we didn't know it before the pandemic, is when we talk about supporting community anchor institutions, it's not enough that there be bandwidth to the school. There's got to be bandwidth to the student.
So the bandwidth to students, do you see this broadband subsidy out of the, I believe it's the CARES Act? What do you think the prospects are for that in terms of it actually getting to the people who need it, and will it be effective?
So this is important, right? There's been a longstanding program called Lifeline, which the Federal Communications Commission has used, which goes to low-income people, but which, as near as we can tell, is used overwhelmingly for mobile service, which is quite reasonable. Think of a working parent who wants to be able to connect up with their kids. Congress in December, in a stimulus bill, enacted a short-term $50 a month benefit, $75 a month on tribal lands, for low-income households, including households with newly unemployed, as well as other indicia of income need. It's really important, of course, to help people get connected. But I think to your question, Alex, it's also important because it could be a test drive for what a permanent program could be like. And we don't know how the market responds to the idea of being able to get the credit.
Can I add to that, Jonathan, that we've been reading the rules around the emergency broadband benefit rules.
Yes.
There's a lot of people power that has to be engaged between that program and the end user in order for them to understand that it's even out there. It's also a question about who they can use their $50 with. You know, who's out there that they can take their $50 to? And that brings me back to this rural electrification model. It's not going to pay for itself. A company is not going to make, you know, it's not a good business model. Having incentives, federal incentives, and financial support to drive down the cost of building out these systems.
Yes.
If people build it, folks can't afford it.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a couple aspects to this, right? This short-term benefit may not provide much incentive to build new networks, but it ought to provide incentive for provider internet access providers to participate. And some of the big companies, including some large cable companies, have said they will. And this means more companies participating than have traditionally participated in the Lifeline program. Moreover, the commission is emphasizing the importance of getting non-traditional providers to be able to provide services under this program. I think rural electric co-ops, right? There are various parts of the country where rural electric co-ops have been very active in bringing really high quality broadband to their co-op members in rural areas. So it's really important that this program be operated to encourage those kinds of non-traditional providers. But your last point, I think, is very important. I think there's a good chance that this year Congress takes up a significant infrastructure bill with a big broadband component. But when governments spend money to get companies to build places where there wouldn't be private enough incentives or rewards to do so, the government is probably funding a network that won't have any competition, at least until technologies change. So the problem is you may have a government-funded network that charges rates that people can't afford. And so one of the proposals we've made is that when the government funds a network, that network should provide a good broadband service, a robust service to low-income people for $10 a month, and just one standard service to anybody for $50 a month. I think that's an important part of the design of any big broadband build-up, because otherwise one could build networks that are not affordable by the people who live near them.
Something we've heard from educators across the board, whether urban or rural, is that they're having issues getting broadband to their students, getting access to their students to the digital learning. So I'd love to hear what lessons you have learned in your work on broadband that could be applied to urban settings. Where are those similarities between urban and rural broadband access? And what can we do to help bridge the divide for both places?
Our research has shown it looks like from the FCC's estimate, you know, fiber to every unserved home would be $80 billion. If you summed up, you know, our best guess, looking at all state spending and the federal money that's out there right now, it's $30 billion. So you've got a $50 billion gap if you're looking at fiber to every home that needs to be solved. So I think, you know, more resources is definitely one of the solutions in order to get access to every student that needs it.
I was just thinking about what Jonathan was talking about. it seems to me like the largest cost is in the build out. So once you subsidize the build out, the rates ought to get competitive.
Well, you know, we've made the decision really in the 1980s when the old Bell system, when AT&T was broken up, that we were going to rely on competition as a driver of both technology and consumer benefits, including price. We have a system that's built on competition, but we need to pay attention to the circumstances in which it doesn't exist. Now, one thing to do, of course, is to eliminate any barriers to new companies coming in. Another thing to do is to use resources that are available that could be employed for local bandwidth. And think, here's an example. The federal government, through its so-called E-rate program, spends a lot of money to connect schools and libraries. So they get, some of them get very big broadband connections, but it's very hard for those connections to then be hooked up to local neighborhoods. So one thing that ought to happen is that if there's extra capacity that's going into these schools or libraries, there ought to be a way for a private provider to tap into it at its own expense to go into nearby houses. Because as you said, Oleta, the big cost here is the build out. But if the connection is already in the neighborhood, then the cost of that build out becomes substantially lower. This is the notion, and it's being used in a similar context by the Commonwealth of Virginia in some pilot programs of what's called open access middle miles. You build the networks into places, but not to every home, and you think that that incentivizes greater build-out. So there's a variety of solutions that are necessary. You know, we think the post office is important enough for everybody to be able to have affordable postage service. If the broadband is much more than the post office was 200 years ago, it's the pathway people take to enter society and to participate in it. So the argument for ensuring that it is affordable through governmental action seems to me as compelling as the argument was for the postal service or public education or rural electrification. These were all places where we decided as a society that for our own good, we wanted everybody to have opportunities.
Thinking again about our listeners today, if you want these people to remember one thing about digital infrastructure and the digital divide, what would that thing be?
So I think that if we really want to talk about closing and solving some of the structural inequity that leads to the conditions that we've heard so much about and folks are talking about now, that access to quality, affordable, connected, up-to-date intelligence and use of the internet is something that we just absolutely have to have. So that's a tangible thing that I think can be done to decrease the gaps that exist in society.
Thank you. Jonathan?
So it would be great if everybody who listens to this came to believe and then told everybody they know one simple proposition, that high performance broadband is essential for people to participate in our democracy, our society, and our economy.
Broadband opens up economic opportunity for rural communities that have been, you know, routinely struggling in terms of jobs, in terms of economic growth overall for decades. There's a great study out of Purdue University that I find compelling that found that about every dollar spent on broadband infrastructure in in Indiana and expanding that infrastructure, they estimated it would yield about $3 to $4 of economic benefit to the state as a whole. And so if you're looking in terms of, yes, closing some of these generational divides in terms of learning that have been there for generations, but also in terms of economic opportunity for rural places, this is a great place to look.
Thank you so much for participating in our discussion today.
We're going to talk now with West Virginia State Senator Robert Plymouth, who's been active in efforts to expand broadband access in his state. He's a member of the West Virginia Broadband Enhancement Council, and last year was appointed to serve on the FCC's Intergovernmental Advisory Committee on Telecommunications. Robert is also the chairman of Thundercloud, a nonprofit that works to bring high-capacity broadband to underserved areas of West Virginia. He spoke with Richmond Fed regional economist Alex Marré about how state governments can address the digital divide and the innovative approaches they're taking in West Virginia.
I think you've really pioneered a project that is a good model for lots of places that don't have broadband coverage or have inadequate broadband coverage. Could you speak a little bit about the Thundercloud project?
Well, it took us about 2 to 3 years to really come up with the model that we thought would work for West Virginia. And what we based it upon is the anchor institution models, where we use the schools, health libraries. You base it on the anchor institutions needing a certain level of coverage. And as you move out to cover those, you also cover the other areas in a high speed network that can also go into ISPs and public. So we're a middle mile provider.
Right. Thank you. And one piece I found really interesting about your project is challenging the speeds. Can you speak a little bit about how you went about that and the prospects of that for other communities that want to challenge the status quo in terms of the quality of broadband that they're getting?
FCC bases speeds of 25 and 3, 25 up, 25 and 3 down. And they say that that is a model for that you have service and you're being served. The ARC grant that we were going after actually had 100 up, 100 down. And we looked at that and said that no one was really providing that. So we went into the businesses, went into the city of Huntington and to their offices and did speed tests. And those speed tests were woefully short of what the incumbent providers were saying they were offering. And in particular, it was very slow for many of the businesses that we were working with.
How did you get funding together to do these initial steps of putting the project together?
Well, what we did was we have an Appalachian Transportation and Technology Institute Foundation, and this group had some money to be able to get Thundercloud started. But we went after the Appalachian Regional Grant, and, it was a matching grant. So we actually had Alpha Technologies say that they would put up the match. That's our private sector partner. So they were going to match it $2.5 million to $2.5 million. And what we did was, after we explained this, our model to the governor came along and said, I not only support this model, he said, I'll give you the match from the state. You take the private sector funding and turn it into, more project that you can do. And actually, we're going to do a data center in the area that's going to be a $12 to $14 million addition to the whole $5 million project. And this is only one aspect of this. We have a regional plan, and this is where I think that where the governor really liked the idea. We're looking at 9 counties that are really underserved. And looking at that 9-county regional plan, this is the first element of it. We have more pieces that we want to put together. And, you have to build a backbone. You have to build a backbone. You have to build a ring and basically create your own cloud. And that's where the name of ThunderCloud came from.
What do you think are the most effective ways for state governments to address the digital divide? And what are you pursuing in West Virginia?
You have to address it on an equity basis. And the areas that are totally underserved, how do you get in there? First, in West Virginia, what we've done is we focused on getting our maps right. So we know exactly. So our maps are more accurate than the FCC's. We've actually looked and said, in these areas, we're totally underserved. So what we're going to try to do is build backbones around that in terms of the state of West Virginia. So we do a lot of middle mile, and then we also help incumbent providers from the private sector that are willing to work with you on open access and different things like that in providing money. This has got to be a very multi-pronged approach. I think what we've done in the state of West Virginia is also piloted with our power companies and Appalachian Power in the region that I live in and represent has done two of the more rural counties. They did build outs there. I think that's going to be supported from the state level in a more robust way in what is coming through in House Bill 2002.
Are there any innovative approaches that stand out to you in terms of expanding broadband access, either locally or at the regional level in West Virginia?
Well, obviously, I think ThunderCloud's one of the innovative ways. I think that the city of South Charleston is really trying to do a municipal broadband initiative, and they're already rolling that out. I think that the state of West Virginia, and I know through the federal government, the Biden administration is really supporting the municipal broadbands and co-ops. We have one co-op in the state of West Virginia in Hardy County in sort of the northeastern portion of the state, what would be considered part of the eastern panhandle. In Hardy County, I think it's Hardy Net. They actually have a co-op. We're working with Ohio State, which is part of our region, in how do you stand up co-ops? How can co-ops work? What we're going to try to work with is the municipal broadband and countywide broadband in terms of county models. Let's be very honest. If you have to show your return on investment, you usually have to show the return on investment on 3 years. We need to do a model that's much longer for West Virginia to try to hit those last 10 houses on a ridge that no one's going to provide. We've got to start looking at that. That's why a middle mile network in the state will help you be able to connect through innovative ways with ISPs.
One of the issues that we face is this, a question around affordability. If it was available, it may be too expensive for the families that need it.
This is going to be an ongoing problem, and we have to find the most innovative way to be able to not only look at accessibility, but affordability is a key. And I think the federal government is doing that in some of the initiatives that they've done. If you look at the broadband E-rate initiative that just came out from the Biden administration, it really targets getting into the homes. How can you set up, temporary access? But we've got to create the model that fits where we can get fiber into those areas, so this is not a challenge every time. There is a short-term problem and there's a long-term problem. And I think we've got to be really focused on the long-term problem of making sure we get connectivity. We have to have open access and we have to have affordability.
Can we talk a little bit about the E-rate program? You've mentioned it. It's a program designed to subsidize broadband service in schools. You've mentioned it, some of the funds being used to actually build infrastructure. Can you Tell us how that works and how you've seen it work in West Virginia.
Well, actually, we haven't worked it very well in West Virginia. We have to look at other states as models. If you look at the special construction provisions of E-rate, and particularly as it allow political subdivisions and nonprofits that aren't qualified to receive E-rates to piggyback on the E-rate construction projects. So a county can actually take some of the funds, and as long as they can show over a 10 to 12 year period, even sometimes 20 years, a return on investment, they can spend their money for special construction to get the connectivity to the schools. So we want to utilize that program in a very robust way, along with the other things, not only what we're doing from the state level, but what the federal level has in terms of other construction monies and the E-rate, and sort of mold those together. And I think we can get the network that we need. So the special construction projects is a real key. And that's one of the areas that the Schools, Health, and Libraries Broadband Coalition has really focused on, is how can you do that? Other states have done it. Indiana's done it in a very good way. Ohio's done it in a couple different instances. Texas has done it. Sometimes they use dark fiber of other companies and are able to negotiate those rates. In Indiana, they did a whole county that way. And now they have a robust, economic development model for fiber that really works not only for schools, but for the whole community.
What policy changes would you recommend at the federal or state level to make sure that broadband expansion really reaches everyone who needs it, especially students right now dealing with the COVID pandemic?
Well, let me first go back to one point that I made. When you look at the FCC maps, everything that you get funding-wise from the FCC and from the federal government is based upon the maps that the FCC has. Well, what we found in West Virginia, and I give Delegate Linville a lot of credit in the approach that he took on the Broadband Council to make sure that we did the speed test. So if you go look at the model or the mapping that we have in West Virginia, we know better than the FCC what our true speeds are and what our service is for our whole state. We need some cooperation with the federal government to let us administer some of the funds, because we know where those underserved areas and unserved areas are by the mapping, and they don't correlate with what the FCC mapping is. So let us have a little bit more autonomy and cooperation from the federal government to allow us to do that. The second is we need to do matching money from a state, and that means that we need to do some things to break down some of the barriers to do some funding. I know the state of West Virginia is getting ready to put upwards of $100 million or so into broadband initiatives to try to match some of the federal dollars. And I think this is coming at a great time. The whole idea of what we did with Thundercloud and what we're trying to do, from the state perspective, is we've been really tired of the decisions being made for investments on broadband and fiber. Those decisions are being made outside of the state of West Virginia. What we've really done is we're trying to take this step of we're West Virginians. We're going to invest in West Virginia in the areas that we need to invest, and particularly from this region. And the area where I live is the heart of the Appalachian region. We have challenges. This is probably our biggest challenge. And if we can overcome this, we can compete. We've always had access problems, whether it's roads or anything, but this one will give you the opportunity to be an entrepreneur, to be able to be at home and work. I mean, it's got so many possibilities for being able to really give you the ability to have a level playing field.
Absolutely. Thanks, Robert. I appreciate the time.
far today, we've talked with a number of experts about strategies to increase broadband infrastructure and digital access. Let's turn now to a conversation with educators and administrators about what that means in the classroom and how we can use technology to ensure all children have access to high-quality education.
Hi, I'm David Bass, Senior Economic Education Specialist at the Richmond Fed. It is my pleasure to be talking today with three education experts about what the past year of virtual learning can teach us about making education more equitable in the future. Denise Khalid is principal of Oakdale Elementary School in Rock Hill, South Carolina, a STEAM choice school. She is also South Carolina's 2020 Principal of the Year. James Lane is Virginia's Superintendent of Public Instruction and has earned national recognition for his use of technology and data in education. Mary Suter is an Assistant Vice President at the St. Louis Fed. She leads the bank's award-winning economic education team, which has developed numerous online resources for students at all grade levels. Thank you all for being here today. What do you think was the biggest thing that we can learn from this period that should be kept in mind as states, districts, and schools define what education will look like in the future?
I think we just learned, you know, that the equity is a gap is a lot bigger than any of us probably even knew or understood. So a lot of collaboration with it was a community effort. And we were learning that we had to talk with our daycares, our church programs, our local, our Comporium, which was our internet provider, and looking at how we could collaborate on making sure that supports were equitable for everyone. You know, we were experimenting with e-learning before for like weather days and that sort of thing, and knew that kids would have different types of supports. But when you had it for this duration, it just really magnified the need of resources in terms of the learning management systems, devices, and making sure that everyone understood how you learned. I know that virtual learning is here to stay, and I think it creates a viable option for families and for some kids who definitely need it, but we've got to do a lot of instruction in terms of who is best suited for that type of learning experience and what types of supports are essential for that type of learning experience.
Something that I hope we've learned as a large community through this is that teachers matter, and teachers matter a lot. I sat next to my 9-year-old granddaughter for 10 days and tried to work with her at the computer, and you have a healthy respect for what teachers are trying to do in the classroom every day. So I hope that we as individuals, as families, as parents, we carry forward that respect for teachers and what they're trying to achieve with our children every day and how hard it is, mm-hmm. and provide them with the support that they need to do so.
Virtual learning today is not what we saw a year ago when we closed schools. Our teachers, as Mary was saying, have been incredible, and they're so much better at it today than they were a year ago, especially those that had never done any virtual teaching. And so I think that, like Denise said, that's here to stay, and they've gained these incredible skills over the last year, and I think we're going to be able to leverage that in the future. You're going to see a lot more blended learning going on. You're going to see students, you know, maybe moving in and out of virtual settings. I think you're going to see some students potentially choose to be virtual, you know, the rest of their career, especially as they get into high school, because now, at least in the Commonwealth of Virginia, you can earn your entire high school degree online in our virtual Virginia solution. Also, you know, as a state, and I know many other states did this, we purchased a statewide learning management system. Well, the collaboration that teachers are going to be able to experience, because every teacher is in the same system. Third grade teacher in Fairfax can learn from a third grade teacher in Virginia Beach, and they can share resources. And as a state, we can build curriculum and push it out to everyone at the touch of a button. That's pretty incredible.
Well, James, you just touched upon this a little bit in terms of the potential for virtual learning moving forward. That, you know, in addition to all the challenges, there are a lot of students that are actually thriving in this environment. So how can we, to kind of further that thought, how can we employ virtual learning to better meet individual student needs moving forward?
Before the pandemic, Virtual learning was often used as a way to get access to courses that students couldn't find in their home school. But in addition to that, we now built a foundation for the entire virtual experience. In the Commonwealth, we had most of our high school courses built out. We now have K through 12, every subject that you could ever think of, you can learn. So, you know, you get a student that gets sick and has to go to the hospital for several months, we can continue to educate you live with a highly qualified teacher. All of these facets are going to be huge as we move forward. And this ability to use the virtual space to build out really high quality curriculum, because like it or not, there's a lot of money in textbooks. Nobody uses textbooks anymore. And I try to tell that to our lawmakers all the time. And so now it's about having high quality instructional materials. And the virtual space is going to allow us to do that, especially with this learning management system. There are a lot of things about the pandemic that none of us ever want to experience again. But one of the things I can tell you is almost every principal I talk to will tell you that discipline is almost non-existent.
All right.
Bullying is almost non-existent. And so we got to figure out how to leverage this opportunity to understand what's different about this setting that has students getting along better and have students maybe more engaged in the class or hopefully not too disengaged in the virtual setting so that we can make sure that we can have all of our students moving forward.
Another potential benefit is the increase in computer savvy among students. Teachers have had to help students learn how to use their computers on top of teaching math and science. So this period of virtual learning has taught students some important workplace readiness skills that they may not have had otherwise. What changes might be made to continue that trend?
Our students have always been more tech savvy than the adults, right? They've lived in this digital world from the day they were born. Whereas I think what it's helped our teachers realize is that students have more of these skills than we thought. And we just have to open up opportunities to let students develop those skills and show what they can do. I talk all the time about if we could teach kids some very basic skills, say in, web or app development, they could have a career right out of high school and almost any kid could be doing that. And so I think it's got us as a Commonwealth reshaping our thoughts on, well, what experiences do we want to make sure students have? Because they already have all these great skills.
So I would add that it offers us an opportunity, if we want to take it, to have students do some work with data, because they can access that data via their whatever piece of equipment they're using. They can access data, and we can have them begin to think critically about data, the source of their data, understand what reliable sources of data are. Those are things that couldn't happen with a textbook because the data is always old. The virtual provides us with an opportunity to really push that use of data, big data, analyzing data, answering questions with data.
When we talk about things in our schools, it's like this becomes a real problem-based learning opportunity. To have the opportunity to have the World Wide Web and the connectivity that we can have to do this type of problem solving is very different because it takes them beyond this building, beyond the city, beyond this country, which is huge for our kids to be able to do that.
We've heard from educators that one of their core challenges is parental engagement, particularly in the middle of a global pandemic, when families face more stressors than ever before. What lessons can we take from the virtual model to support parents in staying involved in their children's education? Is there anything that has worked on a local level that could be scaled more broadly?
We've spent a lot of time with our families helping them to support their children just through the emotional part of this and the mental health part of this and how it impacts everyone. And so we've been able to utilize our Zoom for a lot of parent workshops, family engagement opportunities. I think the workshops that we can build for families, I think is going to be tremendous in that respect.
With these new statewide learning management systems, parents have access to the curriculum that we're teaching in a very new way. This is really the first time ever in education that just about every parent has a great sense or can log into their student's computer and have a great sense of what they're working on, what their children's grades are, and, you know, essentially what the teacher's teaching style is, because they can see some of the lessons recorded or even sit in on some of them live. And so I think that this has excited parents in a way, and sometimes maybe upset them in some ways where they've had concerns, but mostly got them excited about what their teachers are able to do for their children. Brings a new respect for the teacher in managing the classroom. And so I think that we have to make sure that these tools continue to be available.
How have you handled the hands-on nature of STEAM learning in the virtual hybrid environment? And what advice would you give others that want to continue to offer virtual learning while retaining an emphasis on STEAM?
I've always said, okay, our greatest technology is like our brains and what the kids can do. However, during this pandemic, the actual plug-in technology has been our saving grace in a lot of ways, because so many things we've been able to do virtually. You know, virtual science labs, virtual art shows. We had a virtual musician who held a concert or an event with our students across grades and was able to show our students the equipment that he uses in creating soundtracks for movies. And then he was able to compose something on the spot for our students. I mean, we've been able to access so many experts. You know, we had to re-envision our STEAM fair, and that had to go digital for our students to participate in that and to have the judging and all those pieces. And our morning news program is DNN, but we have DNN writers, and our kids are creating things on location at their homes or where, however they want to be creative with that. You know, our fitness movement opportunities, the kids are creating and videotaping on location.
Marré, can you tell us a little bit about the educational programs offered by the Federal Reserve System? What changes did you implement to make your content more accessible to teachers and students? And have you reached audiences you wouldn't have been able to reach previously?
The Federal Reserve Banks traditionally offer professional development for educators and classroom resources specifically for teachers who teach personal finance and economics. And so in the pandemic, the first thing that we were able to do, I think, is to pivot as a group. The folks who do econ ed were able to pivot and offer professional development for educators, continue to offer it in WebEx, Zoom, Teams, whatever platform we could work out to continue to work with those teachers. And then I think we were fortunate enough to have what we call the Econ Lowdown Teacher Portal. And that portal has resources from 11 Federal Reserve Banks, the Board of Governors, the U.S. Currency Education Board, and Planet Money and from NPR and other sources. And there are videos, online modules, audios, and readings that are available there. And teachers could go and set up a classroom, enroll their students, and add those resources to the classroom so that the students could use those resources in a virtual world. Teachers could track their progress, pull the grades into their gradebook, and kind of bridge that gap between that face-to-face classroom and teaching virtually. We saw use of the portal increase 35% from 2019 to 2020 as a result of the pandemic. And we did reach what I would classify as underserved audiences, majority minority schools increased as well. So we were able to reach students that we weren't reaching before, and they were using the resources. And we still had around a 93% completion rate on those resources. So that was really positive for us. And we were able to reach many more, you know, teachers across the country, but also in other parts of the world, surprisingly. We have teachers that we reach out to. So when this pandemic hit, we reached out and said, what do you need from us? What can we help you with? And they said, you know, we need to be able to use Econ Lowdown through Canvas. That's going to make things much easier for us because that's our learning management system. So you know, we began working on that. And in July, we launched the connection so that schools and school districts could use Econ Lowdown through Canvas. They said to us, we need Google. We need Google Classroom stuff, right? So in St. Louis, we had a bunch of interns this summer convert these things to Google so that teachers have Google slide decks and they have Google worksheets and they have things. So we took traditional lessons and converted them. So we listened to what our constituents said to us, and then we tried to deliver. And I think that's any organization, if you can rely on your partners, listen to your constituents, and try to deliver on those things.
How are you preparing for the future, and what changes do you anticipate will be permanent? And this is for both at the school level and the statewide level. What do we need to keep front of mind to make sure that these changes benefit all students?
I think the great thing that's come out of this is that flexibility in how that information is accessed and delivered to teachers, that it does not have to be face-to-face. If we're saying that education and being at school and it's essential, how are we going to really support our schools as they work to make sure that we are able to catch up the kids who've experienced this COVID slide on top of all the other slides that can happen for them? So, and that's going to take a collaborative effort. So the way that we were able to innovate and invent during this pandemic, we've got to put that same effort into working in our schools in a collaboration. And we've talked about that respect. We don't want that to go away, just because the moment is going to pass. We want people to remember just how important teachers are, how important our schools are, and how much we need the continued community support. And we really need to figure out how do we make sure that we're not burning our teachers out with having to teach both virtual and face-to-face. I know at the elementary level, we have been able to have the setting where teachers are 100% virtual or they're 100% in the building. And that has been a saving grace, I think, for them. And so how do we figure out how to do that for our secondary schools as much as possible? I know it's a financial commitment, but I think those are some of the pieces that we need to look into as well.
And one of the things that was amazing to me is how fast we were able to deregulate education a year ago. We basically said, we're going to get kids to graduate that need to graduate. We're going to get kids promoted that need to be promoted. And everything was about doing what was best for the kid because of the crisis. And we opened up doors for all kinds of innovation. And so I think that one of the changes that we need to make permanent is always having an eye on how our regulatory process can hold back schools from really innovating with students. And, you know, I know we've talked a lot about technology in this session. Technology is just a tool. It's not a thing it's not a goal that we have for kids, even though certainly we want kids to do well with technology. I also think that a change that we need to make permanent from this time is the intense focus that we've had on equity. We always knew there were inequities in education, and we've been talking about it for years. But the pandemic has highlighted them in a way that's made it a priority for everyone. And then I think we need to make some of this funding permanent. I mean, Virginia has gotten nearly $3 billion plus dollars in federal money after the adoption of the American Rescue Plan goes through. And that's an incredible investment of one-time money. But what's missing in this story is we really need this money in an ongoing basis to address these inequities and to close these achievement gaps and to do everything else that we want to do. And I think we've got to find a way to permanently get our schools to a fully funded status, because it costs more to educate kids in poverty. It just does. And we're not funding nearly enough to do what's necessary there, especially for our students with disabilities. And lastly, I think the change that we need to make permanent is we've got to continue to put teachers on the pedestal that we've been able to see through this pandemic. Teachers have been respected in a new way in the United States than they ever have been, because parents and everyone just sees how much they do.
So we have teachers, community leaders, parents, and others tuning into this conversation. How can we keep this conversation about digital equity going after the pandemic ends? What support can they offer?
We have got to guarantee the internet in every residence in the nation if we're going to be able to compete economically. We've also got to make sure that for students in poverty, that the internet access is affordable, and so that every family has the opportunity to have that in their home.
And I think just in terms of really keeping the spirit of interconnectedness and community, that this whole experience, none of us could have gotten through without everyone doing his or her part. So I'm just hoping that we just continue to really operate like that. We talk about how teachers can't operate in silos and that you have to have collaboration. And it's the same for the different entities in our communities, that we cannot operate in silos. I'm hoping that we keep that spirit going with us.
Well, Denise, Marré, and James, thank you very much for joining us today and sharing your insights. We appreciate it.
Thank you so much for watching today. And thank you to everyone who joined us to share their experiences and insights. In our next session on April 8th, we'll be talking with administrators and researchers about inequities in school funding and opportunities to strengthen our investments in underserved school districts. Our final sessions 5 and 6 will be held on May 5th, and they will address how students make the transition from education to the workforce. Please visit our website at richmondfed.org to learn more and to register for future sessions.